Let's talk about the Gospel of Mark. As previously noted, our man Papias is the one who is the first to mention Mark's authorship of the Gospel. He quotes, this is a quote from him, saying, "Mark became Peter's interpreter and wrote accurately all that he remembered, not indeed in order of the things said or done by the Lord. For he had not heard the Lord, nor followed him, but later on, as I said, followed Peter, who used to give teaching as necessity demanded, but not making, as it were, an arrangement of the Lord's oracles, so that Mark did nothing wrong in writing down single points as he remembered them. For to one thing he gave attention, to leave out nothing of what he had heard, and made no false statement in them." So, long story short, Papias is saying that Mark is the author. He's assuming Mark to be the author of the gospel. And apparently Mark wrote down stories that Peter told, but not necessarily in any particular order. He says Mark obviously was not an eyewitness, but he obviously recorded Peter's work. And he makes this statement about there not being a whole lot of order to Mark's gospel. It is kind of interesting to note that there were no commentaries on the Gospel of Mark that were written until about the 6th century. And then another one was written in the 9th century. So, for whatever it's worth, the Gospel of Mark, obviously in its simplistic form, was not one that was highly studied, I guess, early on. Now, the writer, the author, being Mark, we assume is most likely to be John Mark of Acts fame, Barnabas's cousin, I should say, and so likely he was very well known because of that. He, as we know from Scripture, he accompanied Paul and Barnabas on a missionary journey, then left. He was the cause of the dispute between Paul and Barnabas. He did later reconcile with Paul, and we also know that Peter mentions him when writing from Rome in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 13. So he was known to Peter. He's a prominent person. He needed no introduction as to who he was, and so it seems very likely that that Mark was indeed the author. The Greek is very simple and straightforward, and it's very to the point, the whole gospel is. And interestingly enough, of all the gospels, Mark portrays the disciples in a very, critical light. And we'll talk in a moment just about some of the themes and things in the book. Now, as far as the date goes, Mark was likely written in the 50s or 60s AD. Earliest traditions favor a date after the death of Peter. Internal evidence favors a date shortly after the onset of the persecution in Rome. And the reason for that is all the talk about taking up a cross and that sort of thing seems to indicate that persecution was an issue. And so from that, they deduce it probably happened around the time of the Rome persecutions, which would have been in the mid-60s. Mark 13 is also thought to be a reflection of the situation in Palestine during the revolt just before the fall of Jerusalem. When we talk about themes in the book of Mark, certainly there are many, discipleship being one of them. The suffering Son of God is another theme. The disciples, as I mentioned a moment ago, are presented in a very critical light. They're privileged to be with Jesus, but they're also perplexed. They don't understand. There's a lot of passages describing their lack of clarity and understanding of who Jesus was. And so the whole book is intensely ironic. Jesus, from the beginning, is presented as the Son of God, but he's known first to the demons, and then vaguely to the disciples, and then paradoxically to a soldier at the very end. And so you have this irony kind of built into the gospel. The portrayal of the disciples is, of course, both negative and positive. Of course, Mark's readers, I would assume, as we do today, would identify themselves with the disciples. And so the message seems to be mainly one of warning against smugness and self-assurance. And so he seems to be saying to us that if you think you're an insider, you may not be. And if you think you understand, watch out. And so that seems to be sort of the tone that Mark writes his gospel with. We think about, in terms of literary structure, I mentioned already that the Greek of Mark is rather clumsy. There's no There seems to be no clean linear development in terms of how the gospel progresses, as there is, say, for instance, in Luke Acts. Mark has a way of making you look twice. There are a lot of couplets and matching sets throughout the gospel. For instance, there's a miracle on water in chapter 4 in verse 35 to 41. And then again, another one in chapter 6, verse 45 to 52. There are healings in Mark 5, 21 to 42 that correspond to healings in Mark 7, 31 to 37. There's the multiplication of the bread in chapter 6, verse 34, and it happens again in chapter 8. And so in the sayings on the meaning of bread in chapter 6 is matched by another type of similar explanation in chapter 8. So there's these couplets that seem to mirror one another in how it's put together. Mark also has a fondness for threes. There are three seed parables. There are three popular opinions about John in chapter 6. There are three popular opinions about Jesus in chapter 8. There are three predictions of the passion in chapters 8, 9, and 10. There are three failures of the disciples to stay awake in the garden, and so on and so forth. A lot of threes in the Gospel of Mark. Mark's framing technique seems to be, more on a broad scale. For instance, Jesus heals two blind men. The first is healed only gradually, and it occurs immediately before the question about Jesus' identity in chapter 8, verse 22 to 26. The second man's healing is immediate and leads to Bartimaeus following Jesus on the way in chapter 10, verse 46 to 52. In between these two healings, which symbolize the turn from blindness to sight and from sight to commitment, Mark has placed Jesus' most explicit instructions to his followers on his identity and on their call. And so there does seem to be some order to what Mark is doing, and I think we can learn some things even as we think about how that gospel is put together. There are some textual issues you should be aware of when you approach the Gospel of Mark. There is a longer ending. Most of our Bibles, you have the long ending. You might notice a little notation that says that verses, I think it's 9 and following, were not in the earliest transcripts. And so that longer ending is missing from two of the most important manuscripts that we have of the Gospel of Mark, as well as a number of others. Jerome and Eusebius both state that the best manuscripts do not contain the long ending. There are three different endings actually to the gospel that exist. So this suggests uncertainty as to whether or not there actually was anything there after verse 8 originally. The oldest and best manuscripts end at verse 8, chapter 16, verse 8, where it says, "The women who had come to the tomb to anoint Jesus fled, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." Now, the basic rule of textual criticism is that the best attested, the shorter and the harder readings are generally to be preferred to readings that are longer, smoother, and less well attested in manuscripts. And so, based on that simple principle, those principles, then certainly we would take the shorter one to be the one that was original to Mark. The longer ending does not flow naturally from verse 8. And so when you think about what does that mean, the short ending is kind of an opening. So the good news about Jesus' resurrection does not reduce the mystery, but it actually heightens it. And readers are invited to wonder, who is this guy? Who is this man? And so it doesn't have a clean ending, and it actually is that way on purpose for us to really question ourselves and our following of Jesus. I hope these things have been helpful for you as you dig into the Gospel of Mark. Don't forget to get back into the textbook, and there'll be a lot more information for you there.